Amen.
This is the day that the Lord has made. And we rejoice and be glad in
it. Amen.
I thought the worship. We go from the book of Psalms. The second number of the song. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. When I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, tell them the mountain. Thank you. Nixon, I need y'all to do an instrumental for him. 204, Old Little Town, Bethlehem. That's how I think it's moving the preacher by the priest. Thank you. who are going through, those persons who are suffering from this COVID-19 virus directly and indirectly. Pray for all of these nurses and doctors and attendants who are under an extreme amount of stress. Today is my ex-wife's birthday, Sister Faye Singer Haynes. Sister Priscilla's birthday is today. 13th. Don Ray, what is your name, Don Ray? Is Don Ray's birthday too? How many people on the 13th? Now the world 13 is an unlucky number, but since we don't believe in luck, that means it's an extra blessing. I have a real big blessing for my birthday today. Give God some praise. Birthday, so I didn't leave anybody out. I thank God for these talented musicians. Give God some praise for them. God bless you. And makes a difference, son. I'm glad to see Larry today. Amen. Bless our heart. Give God some praise. Every time I see him, I think about Sister Jordan. I wouldn't have known it wasn't for him. She introduced me to some great people. The message you've heard comes out of chapter 2 of Luke. That's one of the places. I'm also going to look at Micah chapter 5. Luke chapter 2, you can only read that in Micah chapter 5. I'm almost embarrassed to tell y'all to stand up because if you do, y'all can get all the way up. See, it's slow for people like JP. But young man, he moves so slow. Michael, in the 5th chapter, 2nd verse, Micah 5:2, but thou Bethlehem Ephrathah, thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from the old, from the everlasting. And then Luke chapter 2 and verse 4. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth to Judea unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David. For a few minutes, I'm going to talk on the subject, the light of the Lord. Whatever else Christmas means, it means a lot of lights. I have some lights and your decoration kind of blurry, dreary. But the best saints always walk in the light of the Lord. I think you should see that this matter of walking in God's light makes a difference between whether you are happy or sad.
All right.
Walking in the light of the Lord makes a difference between whether you're hopeful or hopeless. Mm. this matter of walking in the life of the Lord, in essence, comprehends this concept of walking in the will of the Lord. Oh, preacher, I got to say that. I've got to be in his will in order for me to be complete.
Simple.
When you look through, the one thing you recognize is that God has a plan for man. This matter of Jesus being born in Bethlehem was not an accident. This matter of Jesus being born was not some haphazard circumstance event. It's a matter of the fact that God had a plan for man's salvation.
Yeah.
Do I have a witness today? Isaiah 2, verses 2 through 4, and Micah chapter 4, verses 1 through 3, are identical scriptures. Isaiah chapter 2, verses 2, 3, and 4 are identical to Micah chapter 4, verses 1, 2, and 3. They are the same verbatim. Not because they said, well, you see, that's why the problem is fire, because you just repeat yourself. Well, I don't have a problem with a writer looking at another writer and being convinced that the words are worth repeating.
Yeah.
Yeah. There are some things that are worth repeating.
Yeah, yeah.
Do I have a witness here? But when you read the words, you see that God is up to something. God has a plan for mankind. You see, this word Ephrathah is the Old Testament place for what they call, we call now Bethlehem. That word Ephrathah means fruitful, increase. It talks about growth. It's an Old Testament concept of Bethlehem, but it's also this concept of being fruitful. If I want to have a fruitful life, if I want to have a meaningful life as it relates to God's ordaining it, I got to be fruitful and I got to grow. Well, some folk are satisfied just remaining the way they are. I was listening to an interview with D.C. Curry. He's a comedian. I always admire his repetition, his boom, boom, boom. He's so fast, and makes you laugh. But I had a chance to see him in a serious interview when he was talking about his career. He was saying that maybe my career did not take off because I wouldn't compromise the way some folk want me to compromise. And he kind of, the interviewer kind of got the details of it. He said they wanted him to wear a dress, which I had to witness it. See, I'm talking about Dave Chappelle, the big part of me head, and Ricky walked away with that money. They wanted to put him in a dress. Just on the side, they ain't got to do with the sermon, but there's something wrong when you always want to put me in a dress. Like all of them said the same thing. Why would all these beautiful black women, all these great black actresses, why you got to get a man to put on the dress? Yeah. Why you can't ask these people, why you just let that wear a dress? Why let that be a man? And see, he was saying how he feels like that's the way they get you to be disrespected. They disrespect you by getting you to dishonor yourself. You denounce your claim, your manhood. You denounce who you are. The world wants to degrade you. A lot of you kind of down on Bill Cosby. I kind of got a different viewpoint even on that. You know, I understand, I accept that some of these women, but first person I had, why it takes you 40 years to come and confess. You're trying to help somebody, look at all the women who died during those 40 years. But the other thing is that for all the good the man has done, all of a sudden you got to tear him down. He's the nation's number one black man, and all of a sudden you want
want to make him be great. Why is it Michael Jackson accomplished so much, but all of a sudden you want to taint his legacy by talking about him molesting children? But it might not be at all. But why is it every time a black man reaches height in this country, you got to start a rumor that's negative and trying to pull him down? We don't want Dr. King because he spoke. I don't care if he spoke or not. He still did a great job. You got to understand. That we got to give credit where credit is due. And how the devil you going to honor a fool like Donald Trump? You got the nerve enough to talk about myself. I can't wake up and see. Still, the thought that we got to understand that God is in control. And you got to be fruitful with your life and give God the glory. If you got that, I'm going to sit down and speak today. Well, look. I want to start off with the place and the plan. The place and the plan. The place and the plan. Not only does God have a plan for your life, but in order for that plan to come to fruition, you've got to be in the right place. I said, the passage demonstrates that God had a plan for man's salvation. He gives us the plan for his salvation, but he also gives us the place of the birth of the salvation. I wish I had a witness to that. There's no accident. He said, I got a plan, but I got to make sure the plan comes to fruition. So I want the plan to come to fruition in Bethlehem. Oh, God is awesome. He's awesome. The word Bethlehem does not exist anywhere in the Old Testament. Except in that verse I read for you right there. I told you, you see Ephraim in the other passage, but the word Bethlehem is the only verse here in Micah. That word Bethlehem means house of bread. The word Bethlehem means house of bread. Isn't it amazing that he chooses a place called house of bread for the birth of the bread of life? I'm going to get you where you need to be. But he showed you there's a thread connecting God with the plan. David comes on the scene, but David doesn't just come out of nowhere. You can see the thread all the way back to Genesis. Go ahead and finish it. And God has a people, and God's people has descendants. One of them is Judah, and Judah has a descendant, and this descendant is David, and David is the great king. And so we see God is in control, and God says, I'm going to make a blessing come out of this seed, and this blessing will be a blessing to all nations. And then he made sure that the place, the seed was in the right place at the right time. I said, he said, Caesar Augustus, I told you before, he thinks he's in charge, but it really ain't about Caesar Augustus. It's really all about the Lord. I wish I had a witness here. That God is in control. And God says, I need my son to be born in Bethlehem. And not like the other day, they didn't have a whole lot of Bibles there. You don't see a whole lot of people reading the Bible and trying to make the Bible come true. They didn't have a lot of written word. They knew certain patterns. They knew a lot of songs. They could sing those songs. But Joseph had no idea that God said the baby was supposed to be born in Bethlehem. But Caesar has a decree to get him where God wants him to be. And you see, a lot of folks mess this up because you think that Caesar is in control. And so you're trying to get a Caesar hookup. You're trying to get a Roman book of you trying to make sure things are right between you and Rome. And you need to understand, you need to get things right with you and God.
Yeah.
That Caesar thinks he's in control, but he doesn't understand God is controlling him. Oh, heavenly Holy Ghost. There is peace on earth. There is peace on earth. But the peace is caused by people have become subservient and not really willing to fight against the powers that be. Well, look here, not only do I see the place and the plan, but God has a place and God has a plan. But in order for you to be blessed the way God wants you blessed, you got to be in the place that God has planned for you to be in. You better talk to somebody today, man. You getting upset because your life is not going right. You upset because America has got this virus and everybody is running and everybody's complaining. Let me tell you something, baby. Before you start complaining about what's going wrong, you better complain about, you better thank God, don't complain. Celebrate what's right. They got a lot of negatives going on, but I'm glad I'm here because this is where God wants me to be. I don't even skepticize the fact that the virus is dangerous. Yes, it's dangerous, but I'm not going to just pull my hair out with worry and concern because I know God is still in control. I don't have a hookup with the doctors. I got a hookup with God. They talk about the virus, this medicine they got coming out. This stuff is coming out, and some folks today want to show you how important they are. They can have the first shot. I'm not worried about who gets the first shot. You know, as long as God got me, then if God kept me from March until now, I'm going to keep you from now until next. I'm not worried about all that. God got me. Not because I got a shot. God got me. Not because I'm connected. God got me. As long as the Lord has me, I don't have a whole lot to worry about. Do I have a witness here? I'm trying to say you need to know you're the plan of God. So when you talk to God, you need to know God wants you where you are. Somebody know what I'm talking about. Yeah. These people didn't know what they were about to say. God led them. Always a hand of goodness. God got them where they were. Yeah. See, I got to understand, I got to see God. I got to hear God. I got to conceive and precede of God guiding me. I want to make sure I am where God wants me to be.
Yeah.
It's not always clear. Sometimes it happens by accident. But I have that kind of faith in God. He's looking out for me. God is looking out for me. Do I have a witness here? God is looking out for you. Now, you aren't here by accident. You're not here because you're so smart. You're not here because you did all the right stuff. The truth of the matter is you were talking in front of somebody. Somebody's talking in front of you. You went to a place you had no business being. But God kept you. I see this place and plan. And if I'm in the right place, I know I'm in the right plan. And once I agree with God's purpose, it makes me a part of God's plan. And once I become a part of God's plan, He starts to control my ups and my downs, my ins and my outs. He controls my life. Oh, it's so good to know you're walking in the will of God. Somebody know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I know what it is to live out in the world, but it's better to see how folks think you have fun in the world and following Jesus' glory. Well, I've been in the world. They ain't all that fun. They see a lot of that. Y'all lie about it. But the truth about it is they got some headaches and heartaches in the world. I'd rather be here in hard times with God than to be with the good times in the world without God. I'd rather be here with no money than to be in the world with all the money. It's better to have the Lord on your side. You want to have a witness here? I'm playing the purpose of God, so I'm pleasing God. Well, not only that, I see a particular pattern. I see a particular pattern that God deals in certain patterns.
Okay.
He likes to do things a certain way. And this Christmas story got a pattern. How God takes the least, and then He takes the least and make the most out of it. It's all up in the story. It's all in the story. Bethlehem, a little town. Bethlehem is significant in the nation Israel. Bethlehem. Not be all that big as it relates to Israel, but He said, I'm going to gonna take this little place, Bethlehem, and I'm gonna let little Bethlehem be the blessing to the world. I shout stuff to me. They didn't talk about Bethlehem before. They wanted to go to California. They didn't want to go to Bethlehem. They wanted to go to LA. They didn't go to Bethlehem. They wanted to go to Florida. They want to be over there sitting in Miami Beach. They didn't want to go to Bethlehem. They want to go to Washington, D.C. and New York City. They want to go to the big places. They didn't want to go to Bethlehem. But God said, I'm going to take Bethlehem and make something out of Bethlehem. Y'all still ain't got it. Well, if that don't get you, look at what he did with David. Shepherd boy. You know, we already know the shepherds ain't all that. But y'all heard me preach about David. David, oh, he's a great guy. No, he didn't start like that. No. David was out there tending his father's sheep. And when Samuel came and said, the Lord told me I need to anoint one of your sons, the king of Israel, his own dad. Went through all the sons he had and act like he'd gone through all of them. And it wasn't until Samuel insisted, you got to have another. That's powerful, people. You see, when God told me that I'm coming here to another one of your sons and all of ain't flowing, you got to have somebody somewhere. Says it on another one that he seems for the boy. He's a little running boy. He ain't big. Go get him. I don't care how running you. Go get him. I don't care how you. Go get him. Go get him.
Go have a witness here.
Don't be all concerned about your uniform and your head is all messed up. You got to make sure you're thinking right. Because if you don't, the devil will lead you astray. Put your hand to witness here. Have you ever thought about that? God has already defeated the devil. So the devil's strongest tool is that of deception. The devil can't harm you, but he can deceive you into thinking. The devil likes to point a gun at you, but he don't tell you God took all the bullets out. He can't mess with you. He's no test. He's no strength. He's no necessary for God. Is there anything too hard for God? So I gotta understand, if I got my head on straight, the devil won't whip me.
Yeah. And that's why I got problems. These people always, I didn't vote for Obama because he was for abortion. Well, you gotta think better than that. You gotta be stronger than that.
Yeah.
You know, you can support Donald Trump, but you can't support all these other people.
Right.
You can't stand all these other people. With this, and you can support Donald Trump. Something wrong with that.
Amen.
You want to pull Bill Cosby down, but you can support Donald Trump. Something wrong with that logic. I mean, something wrong with the fact that I can do what I want to twist things the way I want to twist them and say what I want to say. And I'm going to tell you, I've said it before publicly. You've heard me say it before. But the greatest impairment to me with all this mess is going on is the silence of preachers in these pulpits. You're supposed to be God's representative. You're supposed to be standing up for justice, and you're supposed to stand up for right and righteousness, and you have said nothing about these sorry police to shoot black boys in the back and killing black women in their own home. And you think they get the message, then you run and fool around and kill another one before you can get over the last one. Somebody needs to stand up and say, well, if I'm the voice of God, I have to speak against the evils of the world. I wish I had a witness here. Yeah, I'm saying preachers ought to do it, but everything else. Don't y'all try to blame just the preachers. You got a job too. You need to say something on your job. You need to say something in your neighborhood. You need to say something when you go to the restaurant. Because you skin and grin all the time. That's somebody know. I'm not satisfied with the injustices of the world. You talk about make America great again. You better wake up and let God have control.
Yeah. You know, the Bible said that when Jesus came to the world was at peace. Because Rome was in charge. Well, I was listening to reading D. Campbell Morgan. He said something really struck home. He said, it's not that I'm so much for war. I'm against war, but sometimes war is better than peace. What you talking about, D. Campbell? Sometimes people are at peace because they're not speaking against the wrong. See, if I got to be at peace by not standing up for what God tells me to stand up for, that's not the right kind of peace. The only way you can have peace in your home, you got to pull God's name down and worship all kind of idols. You don't need that kind of peace. The only way you can have peace, you got to just announce the Lord and what the Lord has done for you. That's really not peace. That you need to let the world know who you are and whose side you are on.
I
was teaching a lesson and they fired me. But I was teaching God's word. What you think about that? I said, maybe you're teaching on the lunch break. No, I was teaching through an hour, but I was doing God's word. I said, no, you wasn't lying. You wasn't doing God's word, trying to teach a study, a Bible study, doing work time. You were misrepresenting God, what you were doing. Because if you God's representative, he wants you to do an honest day's work for an honest day's pay. You God's representative. God don't get you being lazy and make the man think you lazy and trying to do something else instead of what you assigned to do. Not on God's side. Now, if you're teaching on your lunch hour, that's different. You're teaching during your break, they ain't got nothing to do with that. But you ain't got no business misrepresenting God. You ought to be the best worker he has on his throne. You ought to be the one that's always doing the right thing. ain't all at the right time. As soon as you get a chance, you kind of push a little testimony in there, but you have to do it before you can say it. I have a witness here. Yeah, I'm all for peace, but you see, it's a difference when you got a Roman peace and you got a godly peace. Peace that Jesus brings is a different kind of peace. He solved the problem because he is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Do I have a witness here? Y'all been mighty kind. Let me hurry up and let y'all go home so men don't talk about it. I want to close out by talking about predicted powerful person. Yes, I said that if I want to be who God has chosen me to be, I need to walk in his light.
Yeah.
Walking in his light means I'm walking in his will.
Yeah.
Walking in his will means that God is in control of my life.
Yeah.
Do I have a witness here? And I love it to see you say, well, that sounds boring. If God is fixing everything for you and doing everything for you, you already see the wrinkle is that he controls my life, but he doesn't tell me what he's going to do. I wish I had it with his ear. He calls me, but he has to guide me.
Yeah.
I found out about the Lord. He doesn't give me all the plan all at first. A lot of times he doesn't tell me the destination. He just tells me what's my next step.
Yeah.
Do I have a witness here? Joseph, I need you to go to Bethlehem. This house of bread, man. You need to go there and sign the census to let them know who your daddy is.
Yeah.
Do I have a witness here? But Joseph found out it ain't about a census, but it's all about a Christ.
Yes,
Jeremiah 1 and 12, let me put it in the AK translation. He said, God says, I'm watching time, making sure that it comes to my fruition. In other words, I'm watching what's going on right now to make sure that it's prophetic about what's going to come to pass. In other words, I'm going to make sure I get live back then. But I'm going to make it happen right now. I'm going to make sure that you can't say I messed up, because I'm going to fix it right now. Now it's not that Jacob or Joseph is trying to be what God told him to be, but it's that God is in control. Yes, David said, I do agree with you, Lord. Joseph says, I agree with you, Lord. Mary says, whatever you will, you can have your way. But let me tell you something. Before David was selected king of Israel, God had already chosen him to be his child. Before David became king of Israel, he was already writing songs that God told him to write. Because the Lord was already in his life. Now, God didn't call him just to be king. God called him to be king because he was a good servant. Yes. He didn't make Mary the mother of Jesus because he wanted to make her great. She was obedient when she was a child. And because God liked the way she walked early in her life, he said, I'm going to bless your obedience with a big blessing and make you the mother of the Savior of the world. And look at here, the Bible says he was born in the city of David. Is wrapped in swaddling clothes. If you will for a minute, look at that little baby. He's a strong, weak baby. What you talking about, my preacher? As it relates to a baby, you can't get no weaker than that. As it relates to a baby, you can't get no tender than that. And humanly, he was just a baby. But from a spiritual perspective, he was strong as he could be. He was the power from heaven, right here on earth. He was a baby, but he was a God baby. He wasn't just God's son, but he was God in the flesh. He was a baby, but he was also a creator. in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was a baby, but he was also God. He had the power to speak, and he would live. The speaking being would lay down and die. He was an enemy, but the personification of heaven down here on earth. When you see Jesus, you saw a baby, but you saw more than a baby. You saw God. You saw God in a manger. You saw God. You saw God at 12 years old. You saw God. You saw God walking just to be baptized. You saw God coming out of the water. When God spoke and said, He is my son, and in him I'm well pleased. God says, I'm glad we need about me. And when I've done in me, this God that loved the world so much, he gave us his only begotten son. And this son gave so much that he gave in the world. He was God personified. If you want to see God, look at Jesus. If you want to know God, walk with Jesus. Christmas and celebrate the wrong stuff.
We know that in your house is the right place. We ask, Master, that as we travel through out this land, Lord, that you always keep us in the right place, ready to be in your will and do your work. We ask, Master, that you bless those who have suffered loss recently, Lord God, as they grieve for the loss of a loved one, Lord, help them be reminded, Master, that you created us and that we return back to where we come from. Help us, Lord, remember that. You make no mistakes. Bless God, only you can, those who are battling illness and ails, Lord. We pray for those in ICU and the emergency room dealing with COVID and cancer and all other kinds of illness. Master, we know you can fix it. We also know, Lord, that like David, we agree with you, Lord. We messed up. Mankind has created this world of chaos that we live in today. So we just pray, Master, we throw up our hands and we get our faces in our knees, Lord, and ask your forgiveness of our sins. Help us to find the right path once again. We walk in your will and your way. Thank you for what our pastor has preached this morning, Lord. Help us to always remember that you sent Jesus, Lord God, and he would cleanse us of our sins and all unrighteousness, that he would guide and lead us as we follow him to do those works and many more. Bless God, as long as you can. Give us traveling grace as we prepare to leave this place and come from your presence. In Jesus' name, the Lord says, you have these many blessings and more. Amen.
Thank you.